Is that really good? Okay, yeah, so I'm Steve Mynott. I've been using Perl for about 20 years, starting with Perl 4, mostly Perl 5. I'm hoping that I'll be able to mostly use Perl 6 for the next 20 years. So I've started to write some simple modules and applications using Perl 6, both to learn the language and also to try and help out with the community effort, which is currently focused on trying to launch it this year. So what I've done is implementation of tags. So CTag originally it was a Berkeley Unix utility which was written to work in conjunction with the original VI, which just generates a text file from the C code. So you'd then be able to use VI to jump around within a bunch of files, picking up functions in C. It's been around for donkey's years. If you go to the Wikipedia page, it's a very good page. It explains that how many languages now support the idea of these tags and how many editors, so even modern editors like Atom, for example, will support the tag format. There's basically two sorts of tag format. There's the original one, which is the VI-ish one, and there's one called eTags, which is the Emacs one, which is different. However, this is just about the VI one. So essentially, the main C program that most people use, there's two of them now. The second one was originally bundled with Vim, the X tags. There's now been a very recent fork in the last few months, and this is on GitHub, but has universal C tags. When I started writing my script, universal C tags didn't support Perl 6. However, in the last week or so, someone started to add support to it. But I still think my support's better because Perl 6 has quite a complex syntax, and parsing it in Perl 6 itself is probably easier than in C. So the other thing too is that people have typically written Perl 5 scripts that are generated tags output. And in fact, the one that gave me the whole idea of doing this was one that Tom Christensen wrote at the end of the 90s called B-Tags. And I started looking at that, but what I've ended up with is completely different. So what Perl 6 isn't? Well, it is late. So this is a picture of Duke Nukem Forever, which was supposed to be the game that was going to be launched at the end of the 90s. Was finally launched in 2011 and wasn't very good. However, Rakudo Star Wars launched into 2010, so perhaps Perl 6 got that first. Slow? Well, yes, some of it's slow. Some of it's not too bad now. They have actually got a just-in-time compiler, which means that some not very convincing benchmarks like empty loops are quite fast. The point is that when you're writing a complex new computer language, you start off by trying to make it work, then make it work fast. And the way it's been developed is it's quite maintainable. It's not like Perl 5 in terms, you can look at it, most of Perl 6 is written in itself, and you can understand it. Perl's replacement for Perl 5? Not really. It's not a competitor. It's a sister language in the same family. Also, the idea always was that Perl 6 would end up by being able to pass Perl 5 as well, and that you'd be able to use CPAN with it, apart from XS modules. There's a thing called V5, which is a Perl 5 grammar written in Perl 6. However, that stalled a bit, but I think eventually it will end up by passing Perl 5. So that's what Perl 6 is really. So it's a unicorn, rainbow, kitten, butterfly. No, it's not actually, it's just a butterfly. What it is really is it's a lot of fun. So there's an IRC channel on Freenode. They're very friendly, very helpful. You can go along there, they'll help you with how to write Perl 6. And it's not that difficult to contribute with the Perl 6 projects itself. So if you wanted to go home after this evening and get started with Perl 6, there's basically two ways of doing it. The easiest way is to use Rakudo Star, which is a release that's done every few months that has a base set of core modules with it called Task Star. So there are modules that will pass XML, do simple HTML type templating, PSCGI, that sort of thing. Or if you wanted to be a bit more brave, you'd use Rakudo Brew, which basically builds what is in GitHub. It's what normally would be called master, but it is now called the object module, model, or non, although that may change. So yeah, the command is basically the kudo brew build more, and that will build essentially a bang up to date one based on a particular branch. So that resembles, I guess, probably which people probably is familiar with. There's an ecosystem which resembles CPAN. So yeah, there's a fairly obvious URL. If you go to that, there's a search screen where you can pull up the modules based just on searches using using HS type calls. So star or Rakuto Brew, usually you'd install Panda. Panda is like a CGI, it's like a CPAN type module. The ecosystem itself currently is mainly based on GitHub. However, it's likely to move to CPAN at some point because of the mirroring. So if you were to type Panda install at P6 tags, so that people would install it after running tests, and it would look very similar to how you'd install the L5 module. So for that, I'll get to the source of this program. So it's only about 100 lines long. It does something useful. I'll show you the actual output first, because it's probably... Yeah, so that's a tags file, which is actually fairly human readable. So you can see that it's composed of lines. Each line ends with an S or a P. The S is a subroutine, the P is a package. So basically, it enables you to navigate yourself around projects in a similar way to an IDE. There are other ones that I've not implemented, like constants and constants and labels I've not implemented, because I think methods and package classes are probably more interesting. So in fact, yeah, looking at that, that pretty much resembles probably what you're used to seeing as Perl 5. First thing, obvious thing, is it has USB6 at the top of the screen. There are different ways that, essentially, if you read the design will say either use V6 at the top, or if you start with a keyword which is specific to Perl 6, like class, it will automatically pick it up as Perl 6. However, I like to spell stuff out explicitly, and if I try to run it accidentally with Perl 5, it gives me a meaningful error, which I find useful. File find is a module that would have been installed off the ecosystem using Panda. So that resembles pretty closely file find rule, as you might expect. Rest of it is fairly obvious. It's got constants. The constants are actually built into the language, so it's not like having arguments at work about which, you know, whether to use readline, scalar, or some other system, because it's built into the language. I probably should have explicitly put the tags in there, but the trouble is that C tags is quite an archaic, old-fashioned format, and yes, it uses tabs, which isn't very good. I should have probably put the tabs in, but there are tabs there. Okay, so this is a Perl 6 grammar. I've kind of called it Perl with a U because it's not really Perl 6. This is mainly a learning project for me to understand how grammars work. The really correct way of implementing the script would be to use the Perl 6 grammar itself to parse Perl 6, which would be the intelligent way of doing it. However, as a learning thing, I've decided to do a sort of subset which is enough to index most of the files that I deal with on a daily basis. So the grammar definition resembles a class definition, and I guess the regexes and tokens are sort of like methods within it. So it's like you've got regular expressions, but the abstractions are better. I think there's a tendency for regular expressions to end up as line noise, whereas writing it like this makes it a lot clearer. So yeah, the first line is just a regular expression. Perl 6 regular expressions are different to Perl 5 regular expressions, which initially caused me a bit of pain. However, they're not that you can get used to it. And if you want to continue using Perl 5 regular expressions, then there is an option P5, which if you add that, will just pass it as a Perl 5 regular expression. However, some of the aspects of the Perl 6 regular expressions actually are easier. For example, things like white space is not significant by default. So like the X option that Perl best practices tells you to use, it does that anyway. So yeah, the grammar starts parsing. So it breaks things into tokens. So the first token that's looked at is basically the top token. So you can see that the top token is defined as packages and subroutines. The other thing is that things can be scoped with my hour, so I'll put that in. The packages, it's not just package anymore. You've got class, module, and some other things. The subroutines are the same. I suspect that these aren't complete, some moving targets as well. As I said, to do this seriously, I'll be better off using the Perl 6 grammar itself. Okay, so that's the grammar. So what's usually associated with the grammar is a class of actions. So you can see that at the top I've got an attribute which resembles most what people are used to, really. And it's got a dot there, and the dot means that's public. And if there were an exclamation mark, then that would be private. So there's a method here. I don't use self, but if I were to use self, then it's just defined as self without a sigil. The first thing is that the parameter, so you can pass the parameters into the subroutine signature. However, you can't modify it, and because with this unmodifying part of the regular expression, I have to pass a copy in. So the is copy is a trait. And there'll be two ways of doing this. I could use this copy or just do it as rewrite. However, it's better to do a copy locally within the method. But I guess you could regard it as being a bit like a call by value, call by referencing in C. So, yeah, the first thing there is the name catcher there. So if I go back, that full pack, which is a full package name, is defined as a regular expression. So that's actually a catcher. So I don't have to put the numbers in it. So in Perl, you know, using Perl 5 regexiv, I would use $1, $2, $3, etc. But that's a named catcher, which is quite nice. But one thing, of course, is that Perl 6 is very RO. So what you get back is not actually a string, it's an object. And you have to then call the string method on the object to actually get a string. And okay, so the take here, there's a construction called gather take, and it's probably best to regard that as just being a return at the moment. It does other things beside that. So basically, this just does a return, and that's the line that I showed. That would correspond to one of the lines that I showed you for packages. And the final field there, the E tag field, that doesn't have a sigil because it's a constant. So that method, so there are two tokens here, packages and subroutines. I've shown you the packages one. There's now a subroutines one, where I'm not using a name capture. I'm just capturing out type two. Now, there's a big gotcha here, which is that the actual matches are numbered starting at zero. So it's 0, 1, 2, whereas, of course, in Perl 5, it would be 1, 2. But they're thinking, I guess that's for legacy reasons. It's probably compatible with AWK or something. But if you were doing it from scratch, you'd probably want to start it at zero. And another thing, actually, is that quite frequently, the error messages are very intelligent. And not only does Perl 6 have a Perl 6 grammar built into it, but it's got a partial Perl 5 grammar. So if you type in something that's Perl 5, it will usually tell you how to correct it automatically, which is quite nice. The rest of it's not very interesting. It basically will take, as I said, is like a return. This is where it iterates through the file system. One thing that's different is the colon equals there. So that's not an assignment, that's a binding, which means it's a direct alias. The reason that it's a direct alias is that this is evaluated in a lazy context. So it only goes through the file system as you loop around the app files, which is quite nice. The actual syntax here, so these are named parameters, that colon brackets and tanks that resembles, in fact, you could even put it in the old Perl way of dir, fat arrow, open quotes, one. However, but this I think this is actually quite a nice syntax. Brigades could probably do better. Okay, so yeah, this is getting towards the end of it. So basically, there's just two loops. The loops are how you go through a list. It's actually a pointy block, what they call a pointy block. And you notice also that what's within the pointy block, the scalars, don't have scope on them, so you don't have to put my or our on them. So, yeah, you can tell it resembles Perl 5, except we're using the dot instead of the arrow for the method call. And the slur is built into the language. You don't have to use an external module for that. And the idea of doing splits just with the dots I found quite natural after a while. It just looks a much neater syntax, I think, than the Perl 5 one. So, yeah, but those takes, so the gather here, the takes return to the gather there. So on the right-hand side of that, I've constructed the grammar, and I've passed the actions to it and the line. And it basically just goes through the grammar, pulling it apart, generating the lines. The push, you notice, is a method on that tags. And also, you don't have to put the brackets around it now. There's a syntax where you can just put a colon. And I suspect that the properties are never parts of it. So, okay, that's the final screen. So this is that's quite nice. I guess probably most qualified people can tell what that does straight off. And it's much neater, so you can just do a unique list and sort it, and you don't have to use any third-party Perl modules at all. You don't have to remember whether it's more or less utils or less utils more or whatever. It's just there. And then the spurt is the opposite of slur, so that'll output the files to tags. So I guess what I should now is actually demonstrate it. So I'm hoping that's readable. Okay, that's I'm going to delete the tags file and regenerate it. So it takes a little time, but it's now regenerated. Yeah, that's quite usable. So in fact, the tags file, you can tell that it's been designed to feed directly to VI or the ones I'm using in this case, because it actually has regular expressions here, which is where it feeds that to the editor in order to jump. Most of what I'm describing now is specific to Vim, and I've also I'm using some Vim plugins, and some of the Vim plugins I had to patch to get it to work with Perl 6, but the GitHub has full instructions on how to do that. So if I fire up Vim, now if I just do TA in tab, it comes up with a complete list of everything in the tags file, so you can see there that all the modules used and all the methods within the modules and subroutines. So if I just load up one randomly on a Panda builder. I'm using this on Panda because it's one of the most complex Perl 6 programs. It was just a good test for it. Build them on buffers. Okay, so this is really just demonstrating Vim's support for tags, and I guess that I think VI will probably be very similar, since that's where it came from originally. So, just by a keystroke, we can jump into another module, and what I particularly like is this mode. This is an extra plugin, which is a tags list plugin, which is basically like a sort of IDE within Vim. So you can see that I've got strings on the left with the packages and subroutines. So that, you know, I can just move around there and jump to places. Although you can see that scope is a bit odd, but it's still picked it up. So, yeah, conclusion. So I'd say that writing Perl 6 is actually fairly easy for a Perl 5 programmer. It just seems to be quite natural because it's essentially, if you're dealing with Perl for a length of time, you've seen a lot of bizarre Perl anyway. So seeing the same Perl isn't that harder. In its current state, it's quite usable. As I said, it's not the fastest thing in the world, but it's fast enough and it will get a lot faster, I think, as time progresses. But there are real advances over Perl 5. The grammars are more readable than regular expressions. I think Inge has actually written a Perl 5 module which is similar to this, but I've not looked at it. And then the next thing I really want to look at is the concurrency and async support, because that's another killer feature of it. And the fact that it's more cross-platform, it runs on other VMs, the people are targeting more VM, it's probably wise just to use more VM at the moment, unless you want to debug, unless you enjoy debugging, say, the JVM. But I think there'll come a point where, you know, you're at work and they say, oh, you can only use Java, you just sneak in a recruiter.jar, you'll be able to write Perl 6 at work. That could be quite good. Yeah, it's fun to write useful short scripts and modules again. But it's very much like the territory is not, you know, it's like Perl at the end of the 90s. A lot of the obvious CPAN modules have now been written for Perl 5, but they haven't for Perl 6. There's only a few hundred modules. And you can, yeah, you can take your favourite module and clone it, which is quite good. Okay, so yeah, so I'm just going to talk a bit more about the general what's happening with Perl 6. So basically, Larry at Fosden in January announced that there'll be a beta out by his birthday, which is September the 21st, which is next month, with a release by Christmas. At that point, there were three large items left, or two large items. So the first one is to do with Unicode and making that more easily parsable by breaking apart Unicode. The great blistery factor is the one that they started in the last week or so. It is a bit delayed. Essentially, they started off by having everything flattened, which was very clever and made things quite slow. So they're removing the flattening. And the Git branch was only created at the end of last week, but already quite a lot of progress has been made on that. And there's no native shape to raise, which my understanding is that's not a big thing. The thing that will cause lots of breakage is the listery factor, because anything that uses lists will potentially will radically change. So there's probably going to be some fallout. I guess it's perhaps looking at a bit sort of dark, but I reckon it's darkest before dawn, and I think they've got a good chance that there will be something out by the end of the year. I've created an RSS feed site using Datacross. It's RSS feed reader, pl6.net.org, and I'm also currently writing an RSS feed reader in Perl 6, which hopefully we'll use that before too long. So you watch that for news. Freenode RRC Perl 6, as I've said before, is a very good, very friendly channel and very helpful. If you've got any questions, drop them there, they'll explain stuff. And it's actually still quite easy to help. Even, you know, just looking through the code, you can see obvious typos where people are copying and pasting stuff wrongly, that it is quite understandable, the code, and it is quite easy to help. There's a URL here, which is quite, I'll send that around on London PM mailing list after the meeting, where there's some sort of suggestions, and there's also possible to donate. Okay, I guess that's it. Any questions? No.